The media is telling us, you know, they're pretending that they didn't just engulf the country in a fake story for 4 years, which is amazing. I mean, we are a victim of our own intelligence community's disinformation tactics.
In this episode, we sit down with Amanda Milius, director of the documentary film The Plot Against the President. It details how the U.S. intelligence community surveilled the Trump campaign on the basis of fabricated allegations and worked with corporate media to propagate a false narrative of Russia collusion. The film makes the case that this was all part of an operation to bring down the President of the United States. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek. Amanda Milius, such a pleasure to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. This is great.
So Amanda, I'm ashamed to say that I only saw your film, The Plot Against the President, just a few days ago on Thanksgiving. You know, what actually prompted me to do it was Twitter suspending your account. And I thought, oh my goodness, now I have to see this thing. And I also happened to notice it was the same day that President Trump pardoned Lieutenant General Michael Flynn. All of this happening on the same day on Thanksgiving. Tell me your thoughts about what happened.
Yeah, what do you think about that? Kind of a coincidence, huh? I woke up fairly early on Thanksgiving. I'm out here in Nevada, and so obviously the East Coast was awake well before me, and it was Thanksgiving, so I was being late anyways. And my phone was just going completely insane. Everyone was like, oh my God, your account is gone. What happened? I'm on a group chat with everybody from the film, my whole crew, and everybody that was involved, and they were just like, I can't find the account. This is crazy. What happened? Why would they have, you know, banned you? You would think that you would have known, oh my gosh, I'm going to put out this somewhat edgy tweet, or I'm doing something and maybe I could get banned. You know, most people kind of know if they're doing something that's like, even if whether it's appropriate or not, or whether it's the way this social media world should work or not, people kind of have an idea of we had no idea. There was nothing. I mean, there's plenty of things that I would have said that could have been close to getting me banned that I never said, because, you know, we're taking care of the account. The most important thing is not my opinions, but making sure that people know about the movie and know where they can see it, because we need to get the word out. And like you said, especially because of things like making sure that Michael Flynn's story is told when he pops up in the news. I think that our movie does a pretty good job of summing up why this is such an important story for people to hear. And so conveniently, on the day that he is at the top of the headlines again, and the left-wing press is doing what they do, which is attack this man for no reason, as say all the most horrible things you could say about an American, that the movie disappears off the internet. I don't know if it was that. I don't know if it was because we had been very supportive of Sidney Powell's efforts, because we love Sidney Powell and I really support her efforts. And I don't know if it was because we had been retweeting a lot of her work, but who knows? Who knows why? But we were down Thanksgiving morning.
So, but just to be clear, you are back, and it wasn't any of the actual services that went down. It was just the Twitter account. Is that right?
Right. It hadn't been taken off of Amazon or anything like that. You know, we didn't know what was going to happen, because as far as we know that we get attacked a lot by left-wing bots and by, you know, the mob, because when the president retweeted the Twitter account of the movie, all of a sudden, the Amazon reviews, which are supposed to be only people who have purchased the film or watched the film can leave a review. That's really not the case. It seems like anybody can leave a review, because as soon as the president tweeted the movie, we got just totally review bombed. But it doesn't really matter, because our viewers are so enthusiastic about the movie that they couldn't really put a dent in our star rating anyways. But yeah, so it wasn't, we didn't know if we were being like mass attacked by, you know, bots or something, and there was lots of flagging of it. Nobody really knows what happened. It was just Twitter itself pulled it down. Nothing else was attacked. Nothing else had a problem. It was very weird, because there was no warning, and it wasn't a temporary suspension. It was full on suspended. There was no You know, this is for 12 hours, this is for whatever. All we could do was appeal it, which we did. I also shot an email to their government relations department, which might have helped us get back up because I don't know. I never heard back from them. I did that because I happened to have that email address and I had no one, I didn't know what else to do. I mean, maybe I'll, hear something about doing that. But I feel bad for the people who get banned on out of nowhere for no reason and don't happen to be able to kick and scream and make a big point about it in the press like I did, or to, you know, furiously call everyone you've ever met and scream into the phone, my, you know, account has been pulled down for no reason, I'm, you know, throwing a fit. But there's so many people that are still banned that shouldn't be banned. And I've always been pretty vocal about that. And I think it's really, really ridiculous the way a lot of conservatives don't stick together on this. And they're like, oh, well, that person was banned because they're crazy or they're a conspiracy theorist or this, that, or the other. I mean, I think that's just one of the dumbest things that we do. The fact that Laura Loomer is still without an account and people like Alex Jones and accounts that might be a little bit more edgy than, you know, the National Review, they have a place in the public square. And the moment we allow things like that to happen is when we all go down the drain. And I think that's just ridiculous. So anyway, so I was just shocked when this happened to us. But, you know, a lot of people that have really big audiences, like Scott Adams and all the people that were in the film, Jack Posobiec, Mike Cernovich, Tom Fitton, a lot of people that were in the film were tweeting about it and were just... and talking about it. And I think that Twitter got so, I don't know, maybe they just got shamed into letting us back on. I have no idea what happened, but I was the next morning just walking. I was actually buying clothes because I have no clothes out here in Nevada because I wasn't expecting to be here this long. But then somebody, Jack Langer, tweeted it, or texted me and said, you know, the account looks like it's back up. And I was like, wow, I guess it is. There it goes. And we got 10,000 more followers. So, and a lot of people like yourself are saying that they watched the movie because they heard it was banned. So maybe Twitter made a mistake there.
Well, so one thing I've learned, next time I'm going to make a film, I'm going to make sure to include a whole number of social media influencers in the film to help in situations like this. But I actually do want to talk a little bit more about the censorship. I want to get back to that. But just for those few people out there that don't know, what is this film about? What is the plot against the president about?
Well, it is a, somebody said it best the other day where they said it sums up the Russiagate corruption, lies, and disinformation that took place over 4 years in 90 minutes, which is the point, not just because people have been forced by the media to believe something that isn't true and then to forget that they were told to believe that. That's the other thing that's happening, is the media is telling us, you know, they're pretending that they didn't just engulf the country in a fake story for 4 years, which is amazing. I mean, we are a victim of our own intelligence community's disinformation tactics. And I don't think people have really recognized that or talked that. And it's a very dark day for America. It's basically like being bombed by our own aircraft carriers. That's what happened. So I think it's a very important thing to note and to be conscious of, because that's why I made it. But the other thing that's interesting about having it be, the other point to having it be a 90-minute movie that's digestible in one sitting, is because when you take that 30,000 foot step back and you can see all the moves at once, you see the chess moves. When you're in the war, when you're in the trenches and the media is coming at you every day with one story or another, and then the counter story is coming out, oh, there's a declassified document that says this wasn't true. The only person tracking it is like a Catherine Herridge who's sitting there with the highlighter and able to like have a flow chart on the living room wall telling you, you know, what's true, what's not, what happened. And the average person needs to be able to take a step back and see the whole thing. And when you see the whole thing, you see the intent of certain characters and you see the results of certain stories and certain events, and you see the importance of things in a larger map. It's kind of, you see the grand chessboard if you take a step and watch it all at once like that.
So, you know, at the Epoch Times, we've tried to kind of create that picture with some of these, the posters that
you
have actually...
You guys understand how important that is. And a lot of people say that it's a similar, you come away with a very similar sense from looking at the great work that you guys have done to map out the characters and the motivations and the events. It's very, very similar to what we tried to do in a narrative format, in a narrative film format.
So, you know, this is actually quite interesting. With this pardon of General Flynn, there was this, like you said, his name kind of came out into the surface, into the headlines again. But the headlines weren't exactly very positive, you know, and so a number of us were, you know, wondering, is there going to be some point at which these media that have been, you know, basically spinning this story would reflect and say, okay, maybe we should actually tell the truth here.
No, they're horrible. I mean, I don't know how they sleep at night. The man is, I can't think of a better person who has who's in any way at all involved in politics. I cannot believe the shamelessness of the media to continue to drag his name through the mud. And then you see these little uninformed, idiotic trolls on social media, and even frankly, a lot of them have their own television shows, saying things like calling this man a traitor and saying things that they don't even know what they're saying or what they're referring to. They're just repeating it. And that's scary because that is how, if we've ever wondered how countrywide horrific situations happen, like, you know, Stalin, Hitler, things like that. You see these situations and every high school student has sat there and asked themselves, oh, well, what would I do in that situation? Would I believe the mob and go along with this horrible thing and persecute people who are not guilty? Or would I stand up and do something or think for myself? And everyone thinks they're going to stand up and think for themselves. And then you look at this and you're like, I mean, these people just repeat what they hear on television, and they're saying horrific, horrific things about a man that are not true and that are provably untrue. It's really unbelievable to watch. And for someone like myself, who's been skeptical of, you know, I'm friends with a lot of lawyers. My brother is an attorney. He's actually a district attorney, and I'm friends with lots of lawyers, but I've always been very skeptical of the justice system in our country and very suspicious of, obviously, the intelligence community and the FBI and things like that. And so to see this happen in the last 4 years, I was already pretty... you know, I had a pretty solid tinfoil hat back in 2015 and 2016, and it's only grown. My tinfoil hat is very large now, so I don't understand how anybody could trust these institutions. I don't trust them at all, and that's not, you know, that's not on me. That's what they've done in the last 4 years. So, yes, it's really terrible.
There's this critical moment in the film, and this is, of course, in Lee Smith's book that forms the basis of the film in the first place. You know, you have one of the, I guess, the heroes of the story is Kash Patel, right? This Justice Department guy who knows how the system works. And he figures out that he can subpoena all these people that are saying, Russia collusion definitely happened, I've got the evidence, all this kind of stuff, puts them under oath, basically, and asks them very, very concrete questions. What evidence do you have? Do you have any evidence? I mean, I think there's three questions in there. And 65 out of 65 come up with nothing, even though in public and on the air, like you mentioned in the media, they're saying all sorts of things, all sorts of sometimes very terrible things, but then when it comes down to it under oath, nada.
Yeah, and that's the interesting thing about that is that it's not just that they said it in public and who said it in public. These are the heads of the agencies that would know that. If any American in government had that information and had any provable information about the Trump campaign or the Trump administration being connected to Russia, these are the agencies and the people who would have it. It's not even just that they were out on television saying it. If they didn't have it, no one had it. And they were also the people that were going out on television every night and saying the Trump campaign is compromised by the Russians, the Trump administration is compromised by Russians, which is the craziest thing that anybody's ever tried to. I mean, everybody knew it was crazy. When it first came out, everyone looked around and they were like, what? Wait, what? Where did you pick Russia from? Like, Russia? Like, what are you talking about? And it was just, it remains just as crazy. And they just shows you, I mean, it's almost, I wonder sometimes if it was a test, if it was like, it was similar to maybe this mask thing where it's like, how can we test to see how many people will believe something if we just put it on television? I mean, it's one of the most unbelievable things. To just convince an entire country of something out of whole cloth. But anyways, no, sorry, I interrupted you, but that was the other thing, is that they were the heads of the agencies. But yes, it was Cash absolutely did the right thing by pulling all of those people in and making them say under oath what they actually believed, asking them for the information they actually had. And as he said, they couldn't answer a simple question, and that was, where's the dirt?
So, you know, you mentioned earlier how you're, you know, kind of in the middle of it, and it's very kind of hard to see the broader picture, right, that the film shows, perhaps, you know, our Spygate poster and some of the other, you know, FISA abuse things that we've done show, try to show in a more kind of broader way. Because you were with the Trump campaign back in 2016. You were actually in the State Department. I think you were in the White House, and then you left. You made this film, and you're still, you know, kind of associated with this whole battle. Like, what, first of all, like, kind of what motivated you to join the whole, I guess, is Trump movement, or?
It's a movement. I'd been very obsessed with politics, foreign policy, immigration policy, and various issues. Iran is a really big issue that I pay a lot of attention to. Israel. I'm Jewish, and I've studied, I guess a bit, you know, not anything formal. I'm interested in foreign policy issues, as sort of a hobby for the last 10 years while I was doing film stuff, photography stuff. I was always involved in the arts in some way or another. I have a master's degree from USC School of Cinematic Arts, which I can guarantee you I'm the only person that works at the State Department that had a film school degree. And I'm sure that some folks didn't like that very much, but a lot of people on my team actually were fine with me. So, but no, I was, in 2016, I was touring my thesis film for, to graduate from, you have to make a thesis film to graduate from the master's program in directing, and it happened to do really well. It was in a lot of film festivals, and so I was running around, and I had, time off because I didn't have a consistent job at the time because I was traveling a lot with the movie, and so I would take my spare time and go volunteer for the campaign because I was just so interested in what was going on. The president was appealing from the moment of the escalator speech, and even before. My dad is really fond of the president, and he's retired now, and we spend a lot of time watching the news and talking about the news and talking about what's going on, and we both were actually very, very interested in Trump as a political figure. And I like to remind people that the president didn't just come out of nowhere. I mean, he had been making political speeches for several years. One of them was at the signing of the Iran deal. He went to Ted Cruz's event. I think it was a Tea Party event. In front of the Capitol building to criticize the signing of the Iran deal and to critique it. And he was great. It was a great speech, and he was awesome. And I was like, this guy is great. and then when he focused on immigration, I mean, that's my number one issue, actually more than foreign policy, of course, is immigration. And so I loved the way he shook up the Republican Party. I'd say the primary the primary season of leading up to 2016 was the most entertaining and wonderful time of my life. I think the content on the internet reached a new high. It was the funniest and most entertaining things I had ever seen, and it was energizing, and it was fun, and it was edgy, and it was counterculture, and it was cool. And that was actually where all the energy was. And so I was super, super into it and just like drawn to it. So I started volunteering for the campaign, and it was just such a relief to be hanging out with people that were like-minded. I'd spent all this time in Hollywood and in fashion, in the fashion industry and the music industry and whatever, into the film industry. And it was, it was all good in its own way, but it was not somewhere where you can talk politics or talk anything that's very in depth. So it was a lot of fun to be around the good people of, Nevada, which is actually where I am now. And I was volunteering in the closest swing state, which of course was Nevada. So I've spent a lot of time here. And it was just too addicting. I just liked the people I met too much, and it was just too exciting to leave. So I was offered a position when we won to join just to work on the inaugural committee, which is something that a lot of more junior folks do to get into DC and to kind of, get your feet wet. And I did that, and then I got hired at State Department, and I just never looked back. So it's just been my life since 2016.
What was the inspiration to jump in? And I mean, you made this film in absolutely record time. I mean, I think it's kind of the speed that we made our coronavirus documentary. It's kind of analogous, which we thought was a miracle. So when I saw you made this film in, what was it, 90 days, 2 months, I couldn't even believe that that was possible. So did you leave to do this? How did this happen?
Well, I knew I was going to do it. I had optioned the book before it came out, and it came out in October of 2019. So I had been thinking about it and talking about it with people for a little while. And then certain things just came together. Like you said, I worked at State Department. I took a detail over to the White House for 6 months, which was great. Then I went back to State Department, and I was just starting to, I was trying to decide if I was gonna leave and go form my own company and make this movie, which is a really big decision because, you get kind of used to your government job where you just show up every day, fight with people, and then go home leave, go to the restaurant, fight with other people, and then go home and go to bed. But a friend of mine said to me, what do you want to do? You want to stay at State Department and beat your head against the wall for another year and try to get a couple phrases changed in some kind of UN declaration and like kill yourself over these details and fight this uphill battle. Because working in the government is a very, very, very tough thing to do. It's you're fighting ingrained policies that maybe are not in the same direction as the policies of the president. You're fighting bad politicals a lot of time, by the way. You're fighting a lot of people who claim to work for the president who are 100% out for themselves and working against the president's agenda. That's always fun, especially when they get promoted. And then, that's excellent. So that gets annoying. And then you're also getting attacked by the press every day. You've got friends dropping like flies who are being, having their lives ruined. And then reporters going after them, making things up, and then the administration fires them anyway. So it's a little bit like a battlefield. It's quite exhausting. And then at the end of the day, it sometimes feels like what you've done is written new policy in sand, because it's just, this administration is so different from every other Republican or Democrat administration that it is the beginning of a movement. It is not the whole thing. And we have to, this is a 20-year fight. This is a 50-year fight. It's a 100-year fight. And it's, you can get 4 years can really seem kind of rough. So my friend said to me, are you going to keep doing this and hammering away at this? You're good at it, but is this what you want to do? Or do you want to leave and go make a movie that could change everything and that could expose this, help expose and tell the story of this very important moment in our history? And I figured I should at least try. and that I would be, my skill set would be better used doing that. There's plenty of people who can work in the government and hit their head against a wall and do communications in government. There's not that many people on our team that can make films. So I decided to do that.
So briefly tell me, okay, what is this 10-year, 20-year, 50-year, 100-year movement that you're describing? Because obviously this is something in your mind that transcends Trump or this administration.
Well, he is vitally important. I mean, he's the one that just thought, that spoke clearly and thought clearly about the issues that actually matter to the country. And it's almost like we've been in this sleep for generations and gone off track for so long, maybe not generations, but maybe like since the Second World War, you could debate when it really started. But something has gone terribly awry with the institutions in our country, and it is going to take a lot to get them back. They're not working for the benefit of the United States anymore. And the fact that it took, at least in this administration, at least we're saying that now, whereas before we were pretending that the FBI worked for us, we were pretending that the intelligence community still had some value, and we were pretending that all of these institutions, like, for example, even the State Department. The State Department at the moment is, it thinks its mission is to make other countries happy so that they take our phone calls. We're basically doing diplomacy by blackmail, in a sense, where it's like we have to give them money and resources and do what they want so that we will, you know, so that we can call on them again. It's the relationship for the relationship. Ship's sake, and it's not really benefiting the United States. Diplomacy has, you know, fallen apart in that way, and it's because of the culture of Washington, D.C., because there's never anything new injected into the bloodstream. It's just this same corrupt cycle, this revolving door of the, you know, the diplomacy industry, the defense industry, the industry of politics, the president and this administration was an injection of something new. So of course they were going to resist this, and of course every single institution would turn against us. Every single agency that we went to work in would hate us and would think that we were against the mission of the agency, when actually we are probably the best thing for the mission of the agency in its original sense. But and when I say yes, that diplomacy, it's like diplomacy of being held over a barrel. We don't act like we are the superpower of the world, and we don't act like we're even acting in our own interest. I mean, even on things like, you know, in an immigration sense, oh, we can't demand that these countries take their criminals back because they don't want to. And we can't make that phone call because we have to maintain a good relationship with the ambassador and la la la. And you're like, what's the point of the relationship if you can't pick up the phone and tell them to do what we want? So it's there's very simple thoughts that haven't been pondered in D.C. for a long time. And I think the president brought a lot of people to D.C. who asked those questions and thought about things differently. And that is the direction of the movement. I mean, I would say that needs to happen more. We cannot go back to business as usual, or we just won't have a country anymore. I don't think people even understand how bad it is. I think they're starting to. It's the fact that they tried to make it out of polite society and uncouth to talk about America first and the United States as being sort of in this position that needs to be saved, and that Trump is good for the country, that was considered like an impolite position is crazy. And the faster that we can, I guess, normalize taking care of ourselves and saving the country is the faster we can do that, the better.
Amanda, just super briefly, you mentioned that immigration for you is a critical issue. And, you know, this administration, and I don't know, perhaps you, even by extension, by saying it's important and that you align with its position, it's portrayed as being anti-immigration. And I just, if you could briefly speak to what you mean by immigration is important to you, and how you think this policy is different.
Well, if you remember back to 2016, when that was the topic of the election, I'm not sure how and why it sort of faded out of discussion in 2020. I have a couple ideas, but there's people that have different theories. But, you know, part of the reason is that the president actually did an incredible amount to fix the problem. It's the same reason why terrorism wasn't brought up along with foreign policy at all during the 2020 debates is because the president actually has succeeded in so many ways on the foreign stage. But immigration in 2015 and 2016, it was just disgustingly broken. I mean, you could not claim that we had a sane immigration policy in the United States. It was simply preference by proximity. If you can make it over the border, that's the way we're going to choose the people that will populate the next generations of our country. That doesn't make any sense. No other country does that. The idea that emulating a points-based immigration system where we look at our economy and we look at our country and we decide, we as citizens decide what the population should look like and be like, that builds the next generation of our of America is not it's not racist, and it's not unusual. Most countries do that. A lot of very successful countries do that. And the fact that it wasn't even allowed to be talked about is how you know it's important and it's probably a good idea, and it probably will benefit regular Americans and not the elites in Washington, D.C. I thought that the fact that building a border wall was even questioned as a good idea was outrageous. I mean, of course, it's absolutely necessary. No country, again, remember, I really like Israel, and I really study how it's I guess creation and progression in the world, and you know, Israel is really good at building walls, and for very good reason. And every country has those exact same reasons. There's no reason why you know, safety and national security shouldn't be at the forefront of our immigration policy, and it's not. There's things, having worked on immigration with some of the best people in our administration on the issue, like the very best, I was lucky enough to work with. The things that I've learned are just shocking. The amount of scrutiny that people, and more importantly, in some senses, packages and things that come into our country are not screened is unbelievable when you actually look at it. Some of that's actually classified because it's so outrageous, but it's really, really incredible. And it's a very, very huge national security issue that isn't talked about very much. So that issue in general, I think, is of the utmost importance. I mean, who our country is the country. So deciding, having, and it's not that I would say, oh, well, it should be one type of person or another, but even making the argument that we as citizens should decide, as opposed to just whoever happens to cross the border, and whatever country is having a conflict at the moment, that's just who our immigrants are, is nonsense. That doesn't make any sense at all.
So let's talk about the censorship question. I mean, you've actually sort of been in the middle of it now, having had your account suspended of the film. I think the film came out, and correct me if I'm wrong, somewhere around the time when the Hunter Biden laptop story dropped. Of course, it was kind of like an October surprise. I don't think anyone doubts that. But what happened was, you know, in some ways shocking to many, which was that in social media, with Twitter, Facebook suppressed the story. Twitter, you know, actually prevented the account of the New York Post from posting any further. And there seemed to be a near total corporate media blackout around the story. So now, kind of looking back at that, what do you make of it?
It was the same, about the same time period. It feels like 100 years ago, but it was about the same time period that we released it, that the Hunter Biden thing came out. I know, because I kept getting bumped off of my news hits for Hunter Biden stories, and I was like, God damn it, the guy got me again. No, it's a perfect example of what we're talking about. I mean, we don't live, you know who says it? Michael Anton says it in the movie, we don't live in America the way that we thought we did. And that really is the thesis of the film, is it's not the most uplifting thing, because it's not another one of these movies saying, oh, we better act now because we could lose, you know, our freedoms, and we could lose all these things. we're in, the water is already hot. Like, we're already boiling. We don't have a justice system. We don't have, we don't have an intelligence community that works for us. They work against us, and they just punish us if we have the wrong ideas and you know, scare people and operate on fear like the secret police that they are. The thing about the Hunter Biden laptop is that none of them, the intelligence community, the FBI, et cetera, all of the bad actors, the DNC, the corrupt firms in DC, all of that, they wouldn't have been so successful if it wasn't for the cooperation of the media. And the media, I think people don't really recognize how much of an arm of the IC that they are. Again, snugly fitting on my tinfoil hat, as people would have said like 5 years ago, but I think it's pretty clear that this is actually the case when, CNN is giving contracts. The moment somebody walks out of CIA or FBI, they get a contract with CNN, you start to ask if that's a coincidence or if they'd really kind of always had this pretty friendly relationship. Yeah, I think that the media doing what they did with Hunter Biden and the laptop story is the test run for, in a lot of ways, the election. They will not report on evidence. They changed the phrasing. So, and when it began, it was, we don't have any evidence. Then it was, there's no evidence of widespread fraud. Then it's, oh, who the heck cares anyways, Biden has invented a backdrop with something called the Office of the President-elect that doesn't exist, so we're just going to go with it. We're still living in the coup. I mean, we really are. The media is always the first thing when there's a coup in a third world country. Who spoke about this well in the movie is Dr. Lutbach. He wrote the book Coup d'etat and is very well spoken on the issue. And he talked about how in a third world country, what happens is the coup takes place by the opposing group taking hold of the palace or the location of the building of the seat of power. And then the next thing they do is they take over the television station and the radio. And, they broadcast, oh, we have found that the previous ruling party was corrupt and they were working for a foreign enemy. And so now we're here to save the country. I don't see how that's very different than what they tried to do with Russiagate and what they're doing now. I mean, they have taken over the media slowly but surely over, I don't know how many years. And we live in a disinformation world. Another important piece that spoke about that is actually Mike Cernovich's movie Hoaxed that he did with the two directors. I think that movie opened up a lot of people's eyes about what the media was really doing and how little we can trust it. If it wasn't for smaller organizations and citizen journalists and, the non-mainstream media journalists, we wouldn't know any of this. We wouldn't know anything that's going on right now.
So I'm going to give you a chance as we finish up here to kind of end on a more positive note, what hope you see, because you said, some of these things are very dark. But I know, having spoken to you before and so forth, that you're actually quite a hopeful and optimistic person. So why don't we finish there?
Well, I suppose the fact that this whole administration and that the president and Michael Flynn and the people that have spoken up, the fact that they exist at all is what is hopeful. And they give me a ton of inspiration. I mean, I'm inspired by Michael Flynn's story, the fact that he still has hope, and Sidney Powell and all of these wonderful people. I mean, I have hope when I see, Lee Smith, the brilliant author of this book, who framed this the way he did. Him and his lovely wife just had a new baby. And things like that are just beautiful miracles that are, a reminder that great people really have something to fight for, and they need to be brave. And everybody needs to be brave right now. I mean, again, the Devin Nunes's of the world who stood up and told the truth, I think it's really that. It's that each of us individually have to stand up and do what we can to tell the truth and to have the truth be told, because and to spread the word in whatever way we can, because it's the only thing that it has a huge impact. Each person telling the truth has a huge impact. You know, Devin Nunes telling the truth about what he saw and what was real and what wasn't about Russiagate, that had a huge impact on what ended up happening with people like Michael Flynn, who were unfairly impacted by that. It exposed the truth for him. And then people like Lee Smith see this story. He tells the truth. He researches everything and tells the truth in his book, and has the bravery to stand up and do that. And then I see Lee Smith's book, I make the movie, millions of people see it, and they learn the truth of all of this, they tell their neighbors. Every person has the obligation to tell the truth and tell it loudly, because that's how a movement starts. And and each of them had to have the bravery and the clarity of mind to do that. So I think it's just that to me, I think, is really inspiring.
So tell us quickly, where can we see the film?
Okay, so we can see the film on Amazon Prime for free. And it is, if you have Amazon Prime, it's also available for rent and to purchase on Amazon. It's on Vimeo on demand if you're not fond of Amazon. It is also on two free speech friendly platforms for subscription, where we will also be putting other sneak peek, extra footage, extra interviews, extra content on these two subscription platforms. One of them is called My Movies Plus, and the other one's called specialproject.io. All of them can be found on our website, which is www.patpmovie, which is Plot Against the President Movie.com. It's still playing in theaters in a small select group of towns across America, which you can also find and buy tickets on the website. And it is now available for pre-order DVDs at walmart.com, Walmart stores, target.com, Target stores, and soon on Amazon. And it will make a very wonderful holiday gift for your family and your anybody who you want to see it. So it's widely available.
Well, Amanda Milius, such a pleasure to have you on.
Thank you so much for having me. This was wonderful. I'm a big fan.